Luke chapter 2 says, "And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, every one into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and the lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn." That night, we can imagine when Jesus was born there in the barn, how dark it was, not having electricity, not having lights. You can only imagine the darkness in that room that he was in. Thinking about the climate in the area at the time, the Jews, how they were oppressed by the government, how they were enslaved, how they were taxed. There was darkness all around. But just like this single candle that's already been lit, John chapter 8, Jesus says, "Then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life." Jesus was born in the manger. He was born into darkness, the light of the world, to illuminate the world at that time. Psalm chapter 18, verse 28 says this, "For thou wilt light my candle, the Lord my God will enlighten my darkness." These candles that we have here being lit can represent each one of us today. There's darkness in our world, and it can even seem dark and oppressive for us who are here as part of the church. The world is full of unrest, it's full of uncertainty, it's full of evil, strife, wickedness, all of those things. Times right now are hard for people. You see those that are struggling just to survive. There's businesses closing, corporations going bankrupt. Every time you see the news, all you see is negativity. It seems there's no hope, no good news to come. But you and I have a promise today that was given to us in Psalm 18. And I'm going to read it again. "For thou wilt light my candle, the Lord my God will enlighten my darkness." No matter how dark your world seems today, no matter how dark things may seem, there's a promise there that your darkness will be enlightened because God is going to light your candle. And if you have the Spirit of God living inside of you today, if you have the Holy Ghost, I got one more scripture that I want to read for you, and that's Matthew chapter 5. And it says, "Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick. And it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." And so I want to give you some encouragement and also challenge you today. Let us illuminate our city. Let the light of the Holy Ghost that is inside us, the light that was given to this world, let it shine through us. Light up the darkness that we're facing today. Let us illuminate. Let the Holy Ghost shine through you. May you have a Merry Christmas and God bless you today.
Thank you. Praise the Lord, church. Today I was given an opportunity to share my testimony and what Christmas means to me. As a little boy in Sanger, California, I used to go to a church called Life Tabernacle, and they used to take me every Sunday, and during the time of Christmas, we had the story of the risen and the story also, of the birth of Christ. Excuse me, I'm a little bit nervous, but when I was younger, I learned of a baby Jesus. I learned of the Jesus that came to die for me one day, the Jesus that came and robed himself in flesh for me, but most of all, the Jesus that would never leave me or forsake me. As I grew older in life, then I understood the stories they told me when he helped the sick, when he opened the blind eyes, as he told him to go put that hook in the water and you'll get money out of there to give to the church. He always supplied every need. But when I got older, it didn't happen until I gave my life to Christ. At that point, I started to understand what he did for me. He said he would never leave me, he'll never forsake me. But that all came after I gave my life to him. From then to now, I would have never imagined how good Jesus was. Till now, as I walk every day, seeing the blessings. This year has been one of the hardest years for all of us, but yet it shows us that our God has never left us or forsaken us. He's always been there for us through each and every situation. And as time goes on, we don't know if it's going to get better or worse, but we know that he holds tomorrow. And if we keep that promise that brother has spoke about and the promise that he will be with us, it can always become better. And if tomorrow becomes bad, guess what? We're absent from the body, present with the Lord. So wherever we will be, if we are here on earth, he is with us. If we are in heaven, he is with us. Our benefit is knowing that Christ is with us wherever we are. And if we trust him and not lose our faith, that is the best thing we can do, not only for us, but for those around us that are struggling today and not sure about tomorrow. We can point him to the God of tomorrow. Right. And that's what I want to share with you. Christmas is the beginning and the end of our salvation and our faith.
It was a cold and dark December night when a star still lit the sky. Away in a manger, you heard a baby cry. It was the cry of the Son of God, a little baby boy. Born in that manger, to bring the world joy. So hush up, little baby, you know not what you'll do. You'll bring the world peace and love, and teach them while you do. You have nothing to fear, because God will lead the way. That little important baby born on Christmas Day. Many people gathered round that tiny rundown barn. They knew not of what they saw. Then three came all dressed in fancy robes, silks, and furs. This was the first indication of the importance of his birth. So hush up, little baby, you know not what you'll do. You'll teach the world peace and love, and teach them while you do. You have nothing to fear, because God will lead the way. That little important baby, born on Christmas Day, we expected a soldier to save us from our plight. All dressed in shiny armor, ready for a fight. But instead he sent a little baby boy, all filled with love and happiness, to bring the world joy. So hush up, little baby, you know not what you'll do. You'll bring the world peace and love, and teach them while you do. You have nothing to fear, because God will lead the way. That little important baby, born on Christmas Day. That little important baby, born on Christmas Day.
Praise the Lord, church. 2020 has been a good, bad, and ugly year. There's a lot of things going on in this world, as everybody knows. It's been a tough year on my part, family-wise. I lost my little sister. But in return, my 10th grandchild was born. So I thank God for everything. I thank God for that. I was listening to the song that Jared was singing, that we expect a soldier to save us. Being a former soldier in the military, I remember being away at this time of the year. You know, when you're overseas and you're all alone without your family. But I thank God, because you know what? We're here now to get day with our families. People here get to enjoy yourselves with your families. I say keep soldiers that are overseas and in the military in general in your prayers, because at this time, there's some that are out there that are not going to have this, not going to be able to celebrate with their families. But you know what? They're allowing us to be able to do this right now, to be here, you know. And I thank the Lord for them. And you know, 2020, again, like I said, it was pretty tough. But I can give a praise report. This last week, one of my coworkers, his dad has been battling stage 4 cancer, lung cancer. He sent a text out on Thursday saying that he was supposed to get a report on Friday, but the doctor couldn't wait. He had to let him know then. He said that there's no cancer, no more. We prayed for this man a while back. And you know what? God is good. God is good and God is able. We know not what God has in store for us. And I tell you what, that right there lifted my spirits, because during this time, again, with this COVID that's going on, a lot of people are down. But you know what? That's an uplifting for them and their family. And I just thank God for everything that he does.
times Christmas makes me cry. I think of soldiers across the sea, and sometimes I wonder why it's them instead of me. But for my freedom, they give their lives, and sometimes Christmas makes me cry. Tears of thankfulness, tears of hope, I cry tears of joy at Christmas, because I know there is peace on earth for every heart to find. And sometimes Christmas makes me
I'd like Dakota to come up here. Thank you. Oliver and Ethan. Don't they look cute? These boys are part of the light in of my life, and they wanted to give a little something to everybody, and while they're passing it out, I wanted to give my testimony, and Dakota's going to read to you why we're passing out these boxes of candy. Okay.
As you hold these candies in your hand and turn them, you will see the M becomes a W and the E then a 3. They tell you the Christmas story. It's one I'm sure you know. Took in a stable a long time ago. The E is for East, where the star shone so bright. The M is for the manger, where the baby Jesus slept at that night. The 3 is for the wise men, bringing gifts with haste, the quickly they came. The W is for the worship, and the angel choir sang praise to his name. So as you eat these candies or share them with your friends, remember the true spirit of Christmas that never ends.
This is a time of year that's pretty important in my life because it's my spiritual birthday, and I want to share my testimony because Christmas at my home had a kind of a darkness over it because we weren't raised going to church anywhere, and Mother and Daddy were. Just put it this way, it was just a sadness in our home sometimes, and Christmas time it seemed magnified to me. And so in December I was in college, and the whole month I had just been seeking God and crying, and at the campus at college I would run around at night, I'd run around the track and I'd just run miles and cry, just run and cry and pray and ask God to help me, to show me what life was all about. And, you know, and I told him, I said, Lord, I love you, but I don't feel like there's enough in my life. I want to know I love you, I want more. And I guess it was the first week of December, I was in the dormitory and I was praying, laid across my bed, and the Lord began to deal with me and talk to me, and it was very definite. He spoke to me and he said, there's things I want you to do. And he said, one thing I want you to do is, he brought to my mind that land where the Pentecostal church was building. And he said, I want you to go there this weekend. So I told Coach, it was a bad time because it was getting ready for tournaments. And the coach was pretty upset with me, but I told him, I said, I've got to go. So I drove home, and when I walked into the sanctuary of that church, light began to shine in my heart. And that year at Christmas was the best year that we've ever had. And ever since then, you know, now I know that the light, when my daddy has gone to heaven, but he went to heaven filled with the Holy Ghost. I'm just so thankful. I'm thankful that my mother has the Holy Ghost. And I'm thankful that my nephews are preaching and my brother was a preacher. And you know, there's just my little sister and her husband are pastoring a church, and they started a church, which is what Christmas is all about to me, is home missions. And I think, and I thank God, thank you for that December when you began to deal with my heart and the darkness turned to light.
Church. My testimony is going to be a little different from what we've heard. I know we're all thankful for our church that we have here, but I'm going to do a little background of why the church is here and how it got here. And to this, I have to go back and listen to my wife, because she knows things about this church that I don't. The church started going in saints' houses. They didn't have any place to have service, so they started in homes. From then, they went to a rented hall of the Boy Scouts. And then they went to a church on Magnolia Way, which is where the church was when I came in back in 1962. From there, it progressed to what we have the property here today. And when I first came to this property, there wasn't a building for church. There was one house. Behind that house, there was a well where we got our water, and there was a garage. And that was all that was here. From that time, it's been built up. The land to our right, to my right, has been purchased since here. The original church did not include any of that land. Then the gym was put up, and that's where we had church while this building was being put up. From there, we came over here. But while we were at the gym, we had to put up fans so we could have church in there because it was so hot. And after we got this all built, we moved over into here. But we didn't have the exact building we have now. The part to our left was added, and then the roof was added over to this one. That was a completely different building that was moved in. After that was done, the main building here has been altered several times. One of the most noticeable is that the platform has been extended out this way several feet. The original platform was quite a bit narrower. The carpet was added. The breezeway was enclosed because that was all open. The door was changed, and that just the major changes. When we first started, we didn't have any buses. The first bus we bought, or we got in Long Beach. I had to stop and remember. And I drove that bus up from Long Beach. And altogether, we had 5 buses at one time, one at a time or 2 at a time. So there are changes. But that is the main changes that we've had in this building. And the people that came over from the old church, there were actually 4 that are still here. Sister Betty Pike was here, my wife and I, and Leanne. All the rest are not here. So that is the general rundown of the churches we see today, so we know what has happened in the past to get the church where it is today.
Just to be thankful for somebody coming to this town, wherever your city was where you received the Holy Ghost. Why don't you thank God for the opportunity to have truth preached to you? Praise God. Let's magnify Him for a moment. Lift up your voice in praise and adoration. Hallelujah. We thank you, Jesus. We praise you, mighty God. Glory to God. Glory to God. So today on our annual Christmas program, Christmas service, we do take time out. And what a marvelous job they've already done. Aren't you appreciative of all their music and their labor and what they've done so far? It's been tremendous. But we do take out time every year for our Christmas for Christ offering. And many of you have already put that into the offerings, and we appreciate that. But today, if you have not done that yet, we are going to have one of the ushers come through the congregation real quick and pick up those envelopes. I know my wife's got our envelope ready, and others that you may have your envelopes ready. Ollie's got his prepared and ready. And so, Brother Tino, if you can find a, if you can't find a basket real quick, get somebody's hat. Amen. And let's take up those envelopes real quick. Brother O'Brien, tell them how much has already come in that we've already deposited.
You're knocking right at the door of $2,000.
We have already brought in around $2,000. We're going to take what we have collected here, and Brother O'Brien is going to slip out, and he is going to total those up, and we'll do that, and then we're going to come back. I do see one that's not here that I know is going to give, so it should be up further from what we're going to give you. But by the end of service today, we're going to try to give you a total of what we're giving as a Christmas for Christ offering. Amen. Let's take a moment. Brother Tino is doing that right now, aren't you, Brother Tino? All right, while he's doing it, why don't we pray? Pray for North America. Pray that God would bless our Christmas for Christ offering, that we're able to give, and let churches begin from it, souls be won. Let's pray. Pray sincerely. Jesus, I pray for the work of God. We do know that the end time is coming quick. We do know that it is lingering upon us right now. But I pray in the name of the Lord that until you come, we are going to be found working. We're going to be found giving. We're going to be found giving of ourselves in every way that we possibly can. I pray that you would bless, Master, this congregation. Lord, the greatest way that we can fulfill the call of God is to give of ourselves. We thank God for everybody that has come out of this congregation that is in the ministry in one form or another. Pastors, pastors' wives, faithful saints that are gone on into the work of the Lord. We want to say thank you that we have had a part in helping to reach our world. But I pray, God, that this congregation never loses the vision of what it's going to require to reach an unchurched world. There's so much work to be done. I pray that you would honor, God, our sacrifice, our offering, our gift that we give to you this year in Jesus' name. And everybody say, amen. Praise God.
Silver or gold, I'd rather have him than riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be a king of vast domains, than to be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world to be a king of vast domains, than be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus this world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than man's applause. I'd rather be faithful to his dear cause. I'd rather have my Jesus than all the a king of vast domains that beheld in sin's dread sway.
I would rather have Jesus than anything
this world affords today. Than to be a king of vast domains, than be held in sin's dread sway.
I'd rather have Jesus than anything
this world affords today.
Jesus than anything
this world affords today.
Praise God. Let's stand together. Out of the book of John, chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth into darkness, and darkness comprehended it not. Pray with me right now as I preach to you on this Christmas service. I want to preach God is not afraid of darkness. Jesus, I pray that you would help me. I do want to touch hearts. I do want to touch lives. I don't want to merely give a soliloquy. I don't want to just pass time, but I want to be able to talk to people in the Holy Ghost. Pray that you would grant me that anointing in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you, and you may be seated. Into a world that is filled with darkness, the Spirit of God moved. When God moves in, darkness must move out. Light shineth into darkness, and the Bible said darkness comprehended it not. To mean comprehend, it means to grasp. One translation uses the word apprehend. Apprehend means to catch. Another translation says darkness could not overcome it. Another says darkness could not put it out. I like how John said it, that darkness comprehended. It couldn't grasp it. It couldn't stop it. It couldn't put it out. Light always overcomes darkness. God is not afraid of darkness because God is greater than darkness. Darkness is just the absence of light, just as evil is the absence of God. John said in 1 John chapter 1 and verse 5, this is the message that we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. At the beginning of creation, into a world filled with darkness, the Spirit of God moved. And when God shows up, darkness must move out. It's recorded like this, Genesis 1:1-4. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness filled was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the water. And God said, I like it when God talks. Let there be light. And there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. Darkness fails in the presence of God. If you're worried about darkness creeping into this world today, just wait until God shows up. The creatures of darkness will go scurrying away like the rats and the roaches that they are. Isaiah prophesied of the hope that it was to come when he declared in Isaiah 9:2, the people that walked in darkness have seen a great light. They that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them the light hath shined. Thou hast multiplied the nation and not increased the joy. They joy before thee as the joy in the harvest, and as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. For thou hast broken the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, as in the day of Midian. For every battle of the warrior is confused with noise and garments rolled in blood. But this shall be with burning and fuel of fire. For unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. His name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end. I'm glad that Jesus showed up upon the world. He was saying there is coming a baby boy that is going to be born into one of the darkest seasons of mankind. He's going to come to rekindle hope. He's going to come to restore joy. He's going to come to establish peace. Out of Bethlehem, the smallest of the tribes of Israel, came a ruler. Not from a palace, not from a place of wealth, but from a manger. The Bible tells us the story of the star that led the wise men. Anybody know what a star is? Well, I've never walked upon one. I've never touched one. But I've seen their light. Light led the wise men on their way to where the Christ child was. They looked for him in the palace, but the palace was full of darkness. They couldn't find him in the palace. Herod consulted his scholars, who told him of the prophecies of Isaiah. And so they directed the wise men to the city of Bethlehem.
The wise men walked out of that palace of darkness, and the Bible said that the star rose and came to rest over the place where the baby lay. And the scripture declares, when they saw the star, when they saw the light, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. They rejoiced with exceeding great joy. After they gave the baby the gifts that they had brought, they didn't return to the palace like Herod had requested them to, but they returned home another way because they were warned in a dream. Revelation is spiritual light. Joseph carries Mary and Jesus to Egypt to protect the baby Jesus from Herod's wrath and jealousy. 200 babies died in Bethlehem because Herod sought to put out the light. Jesus, Joseph, and Mary remained in Egypt until the death of Herod. And upon the news that he had died, they came back to Israel. So the prophecy was fulfilled. Out of Egypt, I called my son. Out of the country that caused one of the greatest periods of darkness in all of Jewish history, a Savior came. God is not afraid of the darkness. Woo! Hallelujah. I'm here to tell you, my friend, God is not afraid of darkness. Jesus grew up in Nazareth of Galilee, Galilee of the Gentiles. But when he began his earthly ministry, he moved to a city on the seashore, on the coast, by the name of Capernaum. Capernaum was a Roman-controlled city. It was one of their headquarters of their military might. And thus fulfilling the prophecy of Isaiah, Matthew chapter 4, verse 14, so that what was spoken by the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. The land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, the way of the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people dwelling in darkness have seen a great light, and those dwelling in the region and the shadow of death, upon them the light has dawned. I'm here to declare to this generation, the darker the night, the brighter the light. My God is not afraid of darkness. He'll walk into the darkness of your life. He'll walk into the bleakness of your existence. He'll bring that same hope. He'll bring that same joy. He'll bring that same peace into your life. I'm here to declare there is no sin so black, there is no situation so dark that he cannot bring life and light into your situation. There is no life so dead, there is no situation so impossible that he cannot restore and bring it back into a place of beauty and harmony with God. Oh, come on and magnify him. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Do you remember when you walked in darkness? Do you remember what it felt like to be out there in a world of darkness, a world of Gentile sins, a world of all of that without hope, despair, bleakness. But God showed up into your darkness. And I love the verse that Peter wrote when he said it in chapter 2, verse 9 and 10. But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, which in the time past were not a people, but now you are the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. I've got news for you, friend. I have the privilege to walk in the fullness of light. Science has discovered, and I can't get it off my mind. I chose to leave it out of my notes, but it's making its way into my message. Science has discovered that the moment that conception takes place, that the tiny sperm of the male actually penetrates the egg of the female, that at that exact moment that there is a burst of light that takes place. They can't explain it, but when life begins, light is there. I got news for you, my friend. Out of a world of darkness, out of a world of sin, when he was born inside of me, there came light. There came the presence of God. Oh, hallelujah. And now I want to walk in the light. Songs begin to flood my mind as I type these words. That's just part of who I am. Music just finds its way as a very important part of my thought process and my soul. But I begin to sing along with Walk in the Light. I begin to sing this little light of mine. I'm going to let it shine. All around Dinuba, friend, I'm gonna let it shine. Somebody shout amen. Amen. I begin to sing light of the world. He came down into darkness. Open my eyes. Let me see beauty that makes my heart adore him. And what I want to do now, being a recipient of the light, I want to light as many other candles as I possibly can. Because I want to share the light. So my responsibility now is to leave the secure place to walk out into a world that is bleak and dark, and take my candle and light my world. I may be only one, but when you begin to put those together, I'm telling you, my friend, we can change a world with what we have and with what we know. I want to start a fire. I want to start a fire in Dinuba. I want to see God do great things in our city. Don't you? Come on, stand to your feet. Put your hands together. Let's magnify him. Let's love him. Let's praise him. Why don't you thank him for the light? Thank you that he called you.
In the light.
Oh,
beautiful light.
Beautiful light.
Shine. mercy shine bright. Shine all around us by day and by night. Jesus, the light of the world. Walk in the light,
so beautiful,
beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright. Shine all around us by day. The light of the world. Walk in the light,
so beautiful,
beautiful light.
Hallelujah.
Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright. Shine all around us by day and by night. Jesus, the light of the world. Walk in the light.
Walk in the light.
Beauty. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright. Shine all around us by day and by night. Jesus, the light of the world.
Worship you, Jesus. Praise God. Thank the Lord. Praise God. Brother O'Brien, you got an amount for us?
I do.
Somebody told me right before service they gave the amount. I asked him right now, I asked that person, individual, how much it was that they had give online. And it looks like right now we are on the verge. I counted this one, he told me. Right on the verge of $8,200. 81, 80, 98. It's going to be $8,200 or better. God bless you.
Oh, come on. Let's bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Some home missionary is going to be happy about that. I promise you.
Joy to the world. Sing with us.
Joy.
Joy to the world. The Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him new, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing. Joy to the world. The Savior reigns. Let men their songs employ. Wild fields and floods, rocks, hills and plains, repeat the sounding joy repeat the sounding joy. Repeat, repeat the sounding joy. Don't fall in sins and sorrows grow, nor thorns infest the ground. He comes to make his blessings flow, far as the curse is found, far as the curse is found, far as the curse is found. Rules the world with truth and grace, and makes the nations prove the glories of his righteousness, and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders and wonders of his love. Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and heaven and nature sing. Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and heaven and nature sing.
Ready for some gifts?